Hi guys, it's Shelley here. Welcome to my channel and thank you for joining me today. I'm going to be colouring in Nelco Neco's Story of Precious Cats on this video, and I've chosen this very cute summary page of these lovely cats having a little bath in a water pump. I had put up a poll on the community tab to choose between two Japanese books, this one and Inatome Makiko's book Wild Mouse Yuri's Journey, and just by a fraction this book won, so I decided I'd colour this lovely page. As always, I'll be using a combination of my Tombow Dual Brush Pens for basing and my Faber Castell Albrecht Dürer pencils. I'll be using the pencils both wet and dry. Wet mainly for the sky, I think. I don't think I used it wet in any other areas. But again, it's not absolutely necessary to use the pencils wet. You can just go ahead with Polychromos, for example, which have the exact same shades as the Albrecht Dürer, and just use them dry. Even for the sky, wherever I use them, my pencils wet, you can use dry pencils. It's not a problem. It just takes a little bit longer for blending, and that's why I like to activate my pencils with water when it involves large areas. I had been requested by a lovely subscriber to try and zoom in a little bit more on the areas when I'm colouring in a certain area so that it's easier to see what I'm doing. So I'm going to try and do that on this video, and hopefully it makes things a little bit clearer for you. Let me know how it works and if it's better than what I've been doing in my previous videos. Like I do in most of my pages, I start off this page with basing the elements on the page that I know what colours I'm going to be doing them. So on this particular page, I know that I'm going to be going for the conventional or the natural colours of the leaves and sunflowers. So I start off by basing my leaves and my sunflowers, and then I will be working on my background to eliminate the empty space and to make it a little bit easier for me to see what's in the foreground. The paper in this book is really, really good actually for Tombow Dual Brush Pens. So on this particular paper, I'm able to blend my Tombow Dual Brush Pens directly on the paper. So you will see me use a couple of shades, I think, for the leaves. Two shades of green for the leaves, and I think two shades of yellows for the petals on the sunflowers. And I will just apply the dark shades of the Tombow Dual Brush Pen first, and then I'll use my light shade of Tombow to blend out the dark shade directly on the paper, rather than using a water brush or a blender pen like I normally do. So I really have fun in this particular book with my Tombows, because in other books, as I've explained in many videos, it's not possible to blend Tombow Dual Brush Pens directly on the paper without prepping the paper first with certain mediums like satin glazing liquid. So it's really fun that on this particular paper I'm able to just blend the Tombows directly on the paper. So I take advantage of that and I try and do a little bit of blending from the word go with my Tombows, and then later I'll go in with pencils just to give a bit more definition to the shading. As you know, I do like to use pencils and I do quite a bit of shading and defining, so I will go over with pencils. Once I've done the basing of the leaves and the sunflowers, I then move on to do the background, so the sky and the ground, with my pencils. For the sky, I decided to keep it simple and just to go for a nice bright blue summery sky and not do anything too funky. But I did decide that I wanted to add a few clouds in the sky, and I did this by first taking my lightest shade of blue that I was going to use for the sky and outline some clouds in the areas that I want the clouds to be. Once I positioned my clouds, I then just went in with my shades of blue, going from the darkest at the top of the page and becoming lighter as I come down towards the ground level. And that will just give me a good transition into the ground, because I wasn't too sure what to do in the background. So I just decided that I'll try and differentiate the sky and the ground by just making that transition a very light color, band of color, like a very light blue or a very light green. When I start doing the ground, I would go from a darker green on the bottom coming up towards the sky, getting very light. Hopefully that made sense. But basically, yeah, I'm just going from a very dark, well, a dark blue at the top of the page, coming light towards the ground. Last month I'd worked in, I think it was Mythographic Paradise, where I'd done a page on a field of tulips with windmills, and I'd done a blue sky on that page, and I'd added in my own clouds, and the clouds had turned out quite nice, like quite realistic compared to what I normally do with my clouds or my skies. So I wanted to try and reproduce that on this page and see if I could do it again or whether that was just a fluke. So to get the realistic cloud effect, once I've placed down all the colors off the sky, then I will use water with a water brush to activate my pencils. And when I come around the clouds, I will use my brush to try and cause a blurry effect or a blurry outline around the clouds. And then to make the clouds look even more realistic, I will try and pull a little bit of, very little blue from the sky color in towards the clouds, so that it causes small breaks in the whites of the clouds, like you would see in the natural sky. Because clouds are not just solid white. They do have slight breaks in them where there's a little bit of blue that peeps through. And so that's the effect I was trying to go for. And that's how I would do it with my water brush. So I just pull a little bit of the blues into towards the white of the clouds to create some breaks within the white clouds. Especially at the top of the page, the blue is quite dark, so to prevent getting too much blue when you're trying out this effect, I would just dab off a tiny bit on a paper towel off the blue from your water brush, so that you have very little on your brush, and then bring in that blue into the clouds. And you can always add more color, but you can't, it's not as easy to remove color. So I would just, yeah, start off quite light. Make sure you don't have too much color on your water brush if you're trying this effect. I'm quite happy that I was able to reproduce that cloud effect that I'd done last month. And yeah, I think it turned out okay. However, what I do find on this paper is that even though the paper is amazing and it's really good for my Tombow pens, I find that when I activate my watercolor pencils on the paper, it gets really patchy. So you'll get some areas where the color, the pigment of the pencils get picked up a lot more than other areas. So I don't like how it looks when I've activated it. So I usually tend to go back over with pencils. So once I've finished off with the water brush and finished activating the background sky, I then go in with the pencils dry again, very lightly. It's very quick because you've basically covered up the whites of the paper. So there's not much coloring that needs to be done, but I do go over all of the sky again with my pencils just to get rid of that patchiness that gets formed. Now, either it's because of the paper or maybe it's my technique. It might be my fault. I don't know, but I don't like the patchy effect. So I do go over with my pencils again. After the sky, I'm happy with how it turns out. So then I go on to fill in the empty space that makes up the ground. And I keep this very simple. I just use a few shades of greens, so dark, medium tone green and light greens, but I do keep them more realistic greens like I normally do, so the olivey greens. And then I also use a little bit of yellow. I think it was light yellow ochre, so not a bright yellow, just a little bit of yellow to give a yellow effect to the grass. And the only thing is, like I said earlier, as I'm coming up towards where the transition would be to into the sky, I get very, very light. And I do try and keep a little band of white between the very light blue of the sky and the very light green of the grass to just give a nice transition into the sky. So on pages where I have people, so there is skin to be coloured, or I have animals where I'm going to be colouring fur a bit more realistic, I tend to like to complete the skin or the fur, so in this case the fur, I like to colour those in first. Because what I find is, if I colour any elements or any objects that surround the fur areas or surround skin in a portrait page, I tend to end up pulling the colours from the surrounding elements into my fur or into my skin, and that ends up making my fur or my skin look a little bit messy or dirty. So after I'd finished filling in the empty background space, I decided to do my fur of the cats next, of all of the cats. And in this particular book, these characters or these cats are recurring throughout the book. So there is a character page that the illustrator gives us at the front of the book. And I have completed that page. I have decided my colours for each character. And I'm going to be doing the same fur colours throughout the book. And this is because, yeah, I'm not that great with coming up with fur combinations, and it just makes my coloring process in this particular book easy. So I know that when I pick up a page, the cat element or the character element of that page has already been decided, so it's easy for me to get stuck into a page, even if it was just starting off with fur and then deciding what the rest of the page is going to look like. So I decided that I will keep my fur for each character the same throughout the book. I have made a note of all of my color combinations for the fur for each character, and so that's what I'll be following for all of these four cats on this page. And of course I'll be sharing the colors on screen for you to follow. I am still learning how to do fur. I find fur very challenging. I think more challenging than I find skin, I think. Actually, I'm not sure, but they're both challenging. But yeah, so the fur won't look super realistic, but I don't think it's too bad. I think I've done an okay job. Once the fur on all the cats are coloured, I go ahead and I think I start working on my pencil layering on my leaves and my sunflowers. I wasn't sure what other colours I was going to do on the page yet. So for example, the clothing of the cats, or what metal colour I wanted to use for the water pump and the bath. So I decided that I'll first put in the colours of the sunflowers and the leaves so I can see all of that filled in, and then maybe I'll start to figure out what I want to do for the rest of the page. I don't think I've done sunflowers very recently, so I thought I'd spend a little bit of more time and effort in trying to make them look a little bit more realistic and working on that. So I do use quite a few shades for the sunflowers. I will just be colouring one sunflower on screen, show you exactly how I'm doing it, what shades I'm using, and then the rest of them I will do off camera. Like I've explained before, when something is quite repetitive, I do get bored of it, and I don't want to get burned out on this page because it's such a wonderful page. So what I do is the rest of the sunflowers that I'll be coloring off screen, I'll be doing them in little bits. So I will take a break from doing the sunflowers, and I'll be coloring in a different page of mine, and I'll come back to complete another sunflower. So I will be breaking it up between other pages that I'm colouring at the moment. So I hope you guys don't mind, you know, that the way I do that, because yeah, I think sitting down and colouring all those sunflowers in one go, all those petals, I would get bored, and I don't want to get bored of my colouring. So hopefully doing the one sunflower will show you guys enough of an idea of how I'm going to do the rest. Same thing with the leaves. So I will show a couple of examples of how I'm going to do the leaves and how I'm going to do the stems of the sunflowers, what shades I'm going to use, and then the rest of the leaves I will do off camera as well. As I think I've mentioned in other Colour Along videos of mine, the way my process of colouring a page is, or the steps I take of colouring a page, is usually basing, then colouring in the background empty space. Then usually if there is any skin or any fur that needs to be coloured, I'd colour that in. And then I start with the elements that take up the majority of the page. So for example, in this instance, it was the sunflowers and the leaves, and I knew what colours those were going to be. So that was easy. And then the next element was going to be the bath and the water pump. And I struggled with this a little bit because I didn't know what colour I wanted to do it. I do a lot of gold and I've done silver quite often, but I decided that in this instance, I'm going to try and do a different metal, and I decided to go for copper. So that was quite a challenge for me. I don't think I've done copper before, and if I have, it might have just been once before. And this was such a large element on the page, so I was not sure it was going to work, but I'm glad I tried it, and I think I am happy with how the copper turned out, and I'm glad I've learned a different metal combination other than gold and silver. I think the main thing to keep in mind for metal, for any metal, is that you have a big contrast between the dark shade that you're going to use for shadow areas, for example, and the light shade that you're going to use, or the highlight shade that you're going to use. Because that massive contrast, I think, is what makes the object on the page look metallic. I don't know if silver would have looked a bit better on this page, but if you notice, you know, outside in your garden, for example, taps, they're not usually silver, are they? So, I'm glad I went with copper. And it does work. Once I finished doing the water pump and the bathtub, then it was just a matter of me trying to figure out what are the colours to bring into the page for the clothing, for the little other elements like the buckets and the ball on the page and the tube. So that was the next challenge. I needed to colour in those objects before I could colour in the water. Because some of the clothing, for example, I think on one of the cats, the one that's sitting down, is underwater. So when you're doing a water effect, it is quite important to first colour the elements in the water before you colour in the water. So that's what I had to do. So I went ahead and decided on my colours that I'm going to use for the clothing, and started off with colouring the clothing and the other small elements like the duck, like the ball, the tube. And then I finished off the page with colouring the water. So after colouring in the water, the final thing I did was use a lot of Posca White pen on the water for the splash effects, for the little ripples on the water to make it look like ripples and to look like splashes. And I used the Posca white pen to dot around a little bit on the sunflowers and to put a little bit of highlights on the metal elements like the silver bucket, like the water pump, and just to make them look a little bit more like metal. And after I used the Posca white pen, that was the page done. I didn't use any glitter gel pens or anything else on this page. I think the page looked complete to me and I was happy with the outcome. I really did enjoy colouring this page. I love how it has turned out. I wasn't 100% sure whether it was going to be what I wanted it to be, because when I first looked at this page, I was a little bit unsure of what to do with the background. And so once I'd done the sky, I said, okay, so that looks okay. Then I wasn't sure about the metal I was going to use. So on this particular page, I was actually thinking up my colours and my ideas for the page as I went along. And I think I'm happy with how it turned out. It was a nice, fun colouring, a relaxing colouring. Relaxing, I think, because I knew the the shades or the fur colors that I was going to do for the cat. So I wasn't, I think that would be the most challenging bit for me on this page, but because I've already pre-decided what those fur combinations are going to be, it was easy for me. And so it was a fun page to do. I was glad that I could reproduce my cloud effect that I'd done last month. I think it looks quite nice, the clouds. They look a little bit more realistic than they used to look. And I think I also learned how to do a new metal. So I think I feel quite happy with this page, with the outcome and with what I've learned while coloring this page. I hope you guys enjoyed this video and got some ideas or tips for using in your own pages, or that you just enjoyed having me in the background while you were coloring your own illustrations. And I hope that I can bring you another color along soon. And until the next time, take care. Thank you for watching and bye-bye.
Thank you.